What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome back to Beefcake Games. I'll be your host today, Beefcake. Metal Gear Solid 5. This is the fifth game in the series. There have been more than four others, but only five in the core series. So you got Metal Gear Solid 1, Metal Gear Solid 2, Metal Gear Solid 3, Metal Gear Solid 4, and then, of course, Metal Gear Solid 5 Ground Zeroes and Metal Gear Solid 5 The Phantom Pain. Now, Ground Zeroes and Phantom Pain are really just one game. Ground Zeroes is the opening chapter of The Phantom Pain, pretty much. You kind of need that game for a little bit of context for the things that are going on inside of The Phantom Pain. So we're back at it today. Episode 10, or Mission 10, Angel with Broken Wings. So that's where we're going to be headed off to pretty soon here. Before we get there, though, I do want to talk about a couple of things, or at least one thing. So I've been talking about Destiny and the Taken King and how I want to do it, but I don't want to pay for it and blah, 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 blah. Well, you know, the guys in my clan said that it's really good, it's worth the money, you know, that they're having a lot of fun with it. They said they fixed a lot of the issues and all that stuff. So I am going to bite the bullet. I'm going to sell a couple of games I have that I'm not going to play anymore to kind of offset the cost a little bit. I don't usually do that, but like I said, I really don't want to pay $60 for this thing. So I'm going to do that, and I'll pick that up on Friday. So this video should be going up today, Tuesday, the 22nd of September. And then I will purchase The Taken King on Friday, start doing the quests and stuff in there. I'll probably record those and get some videos up about that. And then once I'm ready, and the rest of my group is ready, we'll start raiding and I'll put those videos up as well. I think that's really the only housekeeping issue we have to deal with today. So let's get on with it. Let's talk about this mission here. I do want to talk about, the Metal Gear series as a whole, and my experience with it, and how I came to, be a part of the Metal Gear community. However, we've only been asked to rescue one of the prisoners. I mean, I don't post a lot on Reddit or anything like that, but I am a big Metal Gear fan. I've been playing the series for a long time, and I'm a big fan. So, my first experience with the series was, with Metal Gear Solid 1. It was a Blockbuster with my dad. They were having some kind of like sale, I think that specific location was closing. I think it was a little bit before Blockbuster itself, closed all of its stores and stuff like that. So it was just that particular location was going out of business. So they were selling everything real cheap, and I happened to see Metal Gear Solid. I looked at it. I looked at the back of the box. It sounded cool to me, so I said, "Hey, Dad, can you pick this up for me?" And he looked at it. I said, "Come on, Pops, it's like a tactical espionage action, it'll be like a action movie." And he was like, "All right, I'll get it for you." So I, sweet, scored one for me. I went home, unwrapped that sucker, popped it in, and proceeded to be blown away. I had never played a game at that point in my life like Metal Gear Solid, and I'm pretty sure that at the time that game came out, there wasn't really anything else like it out there. I don't remember if Final Fantasy VII and seven and eight had come out at that point. I don't think they had. And if they had, those are still kind of different games from Metal Gear Solid. Metal Gear Solid was much more cinematic. It had a lot of, it had all the fixed camera angles. The combat was obviously not like RPG combat is, very real time. But yeah, man, that game blew me away just from the opening scene. I had a lot of fun with it. It had so many insane moments. Now, if you're new to the series and you have not played the games, I'm going to spoil the shit out of everything in this video. So I'm going to be talking about all my favorite moments and scenes and emotions and all these things about the whole series, with the exception of most of the portable stuff. I haven't played most of that. But most of it's not canon anyway, so I guess it doesn't really matter. But anyway, so if you don't want any spoilers for Metal Gear Solid series as a whole and Metal Gear Solid 5 up until Chapter 10, then stop watching now, because spoilers ahead. So anyway, with Metal Gear Solid 1, you know, Snake's got to infiltrate. I hadn't played the previous two Metal Gear games, so I was a little bit confused on a couple of things. But really, it was kind of a restart of the franchise, you know, moving forward. And they gave you context for things that you needed it for, you know, as far as like who Snake was and Campbell and Big Boss and all that stuff. But you know, playing through that game, and you have your support team. You know, you got Mei Ling and Naomi and Romanov and Miller. You know, so I'm actually hoping that this game will clarify when Miller died and who killed him. You know, I always kind of assumed that it was Liquid, and Liquid is in this game, so that may be the case. No, he can't die in this game because he was in Metal Gear 1 or 2. I can't remember. Like I said, I haven't played those two games in a long, long time, and I only played them once. Yeah, Liquid. I think Liquid killed him. I don't know. We will hopefully find out at some point in this game. Yeah, so you got Master Miller, who's actually Liquid Snake, masquerading as Miller, trying to, you know, feed you red herrings and get you to do what he wants you to do, which was a very cool twist, I thought. You know, and then you have things like you have to look on the back of the box for Meryl's code. Like, that stumped the fuck out of me. I had no idea that that's what they meant when they said look on the back of the box. I was like, what fucking box? This cardboard box doesn't have anything written on it. What the hell? So then I finally figured it out, and I was like, oh my god, I'm so stupid. And, you know, that was awesome. And then you got Gray Fox coming in with his fucking ninja suit when there's a minefield and you're fighting Vulcan Raven, which was a throwback, you know, to the original Metal Gears. And then, you know, you have your was it like a furnace key or whatever it was that you had to get it hot and then cold and then it would work. You know, just that whole game was crazy. The boss fight with Psycho Mantis, like, that blew my mind. You know, he was reading my memory card and I had, like, some Castlevania Symphony of the Night stuff on there. And he was like, oh, so I see you like Castlevania. And I was like, how do you know that? You know, I mean, I'm like a kid at this point, so I was just like mind blown. And then, you know, it says Hideo in the top corner, and you got to switch your controller to the other port so he can't read your mind. Like, it was just crazy. And no game has ever done that since, actually. And that was a really, really cool game mechanic that I think, you know, other games could utilize in a really neat way, if they chose, but I guess nobody really thought about it after Kojima did it. You know, maybe he just did it in the perfect way, and that was it. Nobody else needs to do that. But yeah, so you got Psycho Mantis, and you have, you know, you meet Otacon, and you have the whole Sniper Wolf deal. You know, that was a very moving battle and scene in general, you know, and then trying to get Meryl, but you can't because Sniper Wolf is just gonna fuck your shit up, and you gotta go find the sniper rifle and fight her. Just great, great stuff. Then you got the torture scene with Ocelot, you know, and if you're not able to mash that button, then fucking Meryl dies. Screw you. You know, that was a tough one for me to get through as well. I eventually was able to do it, you know, and get that bandana, but man, was it rough. And definitely the first time through with that game, I stuck with Otacon, and I got that stealth camo, which was fucking awesome. But yeah, you know, and then you have the final climactic battle with Liquid, and you're fighting Metal Gear Rex, and, you know, Gray Fox shows up. Like, it's just all this crazy, crazy stuff, and the game was incredible, and, you know, I had so much fun with it, and it just opened me up to what video games could be. You know, I mean, it was different than anything else that I had played, and it was just so unique and amazing, and I had such a good time with it. That, you know, when I was done, I immediately was like, okay, when's the second one coming out? Like, when are we getting Metal Gear Solid 2? And then they started talking about, or Kojima started, you know, talking about Metal Gear Solid 2 and showing the tanker and fighting Olga and all this stuff. And everything looked awesome. You know, everybody was super excited. The game looked incredible. You know, the graphics were amazing. You know, it had just different little intricate details like Kojima does. You know, like you could shoot the watermelons and you know, knock the glass over and the ice cubes come out and you can shoot those and interact with things in a different way. You know, when Snake is first infiltrating the tanker and you see that Vulcan Raven shadow, like the first time I got to that, I was like, oh shit, I thought I killed this guy. And then, you know, it's just a toy. Haha. But yeah, you know, and I mean that big switcheroo, nobody saw that coming. Least of all me. You know, I was very excited to play as Snake again. I was definitely, you know, wanted to reprise my role. But we didn't, you know. You played through the tanker, which was awesome. And then, you know, as soon as it cut to Raiden swimming into the big shell and he talked. I mean, as soon as it cut to his character model, I was like, okay, this, I don't think this is Snake. And then he talked, and I was like, okay, this is definitely not Snake. And a lot of people were really mad about that. A lot of people were super pissed that we did not get to play as Snake in that game. But I really didn't have a problem with it. I liked Raiden. I felt that he honestly acted, you know, accordingly to the situation that he was in. You know, I mean, honestly, the guy has never been on a real mission. He's been trained by Patriot AI and fucking Solidus Snake at this point, which is really sad. You know, and so, like, he's been through a lot, and you know, he was a child soldier and all this different stuff. So I think he was fine. I don't think he whined too much. So right there you see the guys moving the prisoner that I wanted to get out of here. You can probably complete this mission right here. You could probably stop that tank, like, if you, like, lay down some EM mines or something in the street. You can probably stop that tank, and this mission could take you, you know, 5 minutes. And you can just distract everybody right here. But as it stands, I went the long way. This is the first time that I've been to these locations, so you know, I wanted to make sure that I grabbed everything I could. There's a lot of tapes that I get in this video. There's three different tapes. There's Maneater, Ride a White Horse, and something else I don't remember. But Maneater is inside of this base. Ride a White Horse is in the next outpost that I go to. And then there's another tape in the final base that I end up in. So I'll point those out when we get to them. And there is a couple of sections that I fast forward a little bit just because it's kind of just travel time and I don't want to waste anybody's time with that kind of stuff. But anyway, moving back to Metal Gear Solid 2, you know, the game was just nuts. The story was just fucking crazy, batshit nuts, didn't make any sense. And then you think about it, and it did make sense, you know, and it was Kojima's way of saying, hey, this is really my final Metal Gear, I'm not going to do this again, you know, like, I know you guys like these games, and I enjoy making them, but I want to do something else, so here's just a fucking totally insane thing that, you know, people are going to not like. But some people will, and that's it. That's all I have to say on the subject. But it turned out that wasn't all I had to say on the subject, as we all know. So, you know, I mean, he wanted to get out of the Metal Gear game for a while, but the games are just so damn popular, you know, and he does such a good job with them. You know, they're obviously, they can be very campy, they can be very B-movies, some of the dialogue isn't the best. You know, they don't age well, they haven't aged well gameplay-wise. You know, Metal Gear Solid 3 Subsistence is probably the most playable of the first three. Metal Gear Solid 4 is still playable, I think. I think that game is fine. The game actually laid a lot of the groundwork for the control changes that they made for Ground Zeroes and the Phantom Pain. But anyway, you know, so Metal Gear Solid 2 was just fucking nuts. You know, you have Fortune, you got this lady who can't be hit by bullets, you got fucking Fat Man, which is this crazy fat guy drinking a cocktail, rolling around on roller skates, blowing shit up. And you got Olga as that cyborg ninja. You know, you got Vamp, who they didn't really explain until Metal Gear Solid 4, which I was okay with. I like that. They kind of left him a mystery because he was very interesting, I thought, and Phil Lamar did a really great job voicing him. I think he was a great voice actor. I think Quentin Flynn did an awesome job with Raiden. You know, every time I hear him in something else, I just always think of Raiden. You know, the game was nuts. You know, come to find out that Campbell's an AI. The whole thing is just a simulation by the Patriots to recreate the perfect super soldier. You know, because the Les Enfants Terribles project didn't pan out the way that Zero wanted it to, you know, with Solid, you know, bucking the trend and Solidus. You know, obviously they did have Solidus and he was the president and things did work out for them in that way for a while, but after, you know, Shadow Moses, Solidus wasn't able to be present anymore. So he was like, well, fuck you guys. I'm still doing my shit. I'm going to fuck it all up, and if I can't have it, nobody can. And so that's really what it boiled down to, was just Solidus wanted to... And I, you know, I haven't played Metal Gear Solid 2 in a while, so I may not have the intricacies correct. I may not have 100% on the motivation. So, you know, if I'm wrong, please forgive me. Correct me in the comments. But, you know, Solidus just wanted to... fuck it all up. He wanted to be in control, and if he couldn't, then nobody could. You know, and then so once you finally find all that stuff out, you know, you're flipping around Arsenal gear completely naked, and then Snake gives you a goddamn sword, and you're just running around chopping dudes, and then you have to fight, you know, 27 Metal Gear Rays, which was a lot of fun. It was one of my favorite boss battles, you know, and Metal Gear Solid 2 actually has, it's the only game with a water section that I actually liked. You know, when you're going through the flooded strut, I think it was strut H, but when you're going through that flooded strut, you know, coming up for air at certain points and trying to look for Emma and all this stuff, I had a lot of fun. Really every part about that game was fun. All the boss battles were great. I liked fighting Vamp a lot, but specifically the Metal Gears at the end, that fight, it was awesome. It was like the fight from Metal Gear Solid 1 just turned up to 13, you know, like... just totally crazy. And then, you know, Ocelot shows up at the end, and he says, hey, you know, fuck all y'all bitches, pretty much. You know, and then you have the whole Liquid Ocelot thing, the beginnings of that, you know, where Ocelot had replaced his arm with Liquid's, and then, you know, of course we find out in Metal Gear Solid 4 that, you know, Liquid wasn't really taking over Ocelot. Ocelot had gone through psychological... deconstruction and reconstruction, essentially, to make himself Liquid for the good of, you know, the world. I mean, he really did that, you know, to end all this nonsense. And it worked, you know, he did it. So he's really one of the great figures in the series. So this is something cool that I figured out. Kapow! I love that. It's not going to sound it right off. That's one of my favorite moves to do. Can't always do it, but when I can, it's a lot of fun. I know. I think I've shown that in a couple other videos, but that was a perfect example of why it's awesome here. So anyway, you know, Ocelot, he's one of my favorite characters. He always has been. He always will be. I think he was a hero. You know, he always played all the sides to do what was essentially the right thing at the time, you know, and a lot of people might say, oh, well, there is no, well, it was the right thing at the time, it was either the right thing to do or it wasn't. But I don't know that anything in our lives are really that black and white. You know, and I think that Ocelot felt that way as well, and he kind of moved with the times and went with the flow and figured out, you know, what was the proper thing to do at any given time. And he did it. And I think that he was awesome for that. And we'll get more into him when we get to Metal Gear Solid 3. But yeah, and you know, and then that final fight with Solidus on the roof of the... oh, some kind of state building. I don't remember what it was. But, it was, yeah, the roof of the state building. Fighting with swords, and he's got his fucking octopus arms and shooting rockets at you and shit. Like, it was awesome. It was just great. You know, and then you find out that all the Patriots are dead, and it's just like this big cliffhanger, and like, what's gonna happen, and where's Snake gonna go, and what's Raiden gonna do? You know, he's gonna go rescue Olga's kid, and you know, the whole time, and like, I liked the story arcs in that game too, you know, like the whole Fortune thing. Like, she's so like she wants to be able to die, you know, but she can't, and then she realizes that it wasn't even her. It was the Patriots moving again to do, you know, what they deemed necessary or the best, or, you know, however they wanted to put it. And then she gets killed, and you know, that wasn't her time to go. And I don't know. That was a great scene. But then, you know, we move forward to Metal Gear Solid 3 and the hype surrounding that game, and Kojima just, you know, trying to play everybody like a damn fiddle. You you know, he wanted to he wanted everybody to think that we were still going to play as Snake, and it was going to be in the jungle. And we did play as Snake, but we played as the original Snake, not Solid Snake. And he dropped some hints, you know, like there was I think there was some kind of like press, like it was like a press release or like a pamphlet or some kind of flyer, but it had like some words written down it. And if you looked at them, and you circled the right, I think it was like the third letter of each word or something, then it spelled out Big Boss. And that was when a lot of people were finally like, okay, this makes sense. We're going to play as Big Boss. It's going to be in the 60s. We're going to figure out his downfall. And that's where this game is going to be about. It's not actually going to be Solid Snake. It's not going to be in present day. All that good stuff. But, yeah, you know, I loved that game. Metal Gear Solid 3 is my favorite in the series, hands down. You know, at this point, by the time that game was coming out, I was a huge Metal Gear Solid fan. You know, I would say that I was a fanboy at that point. You know, Metal Gear Solid 3 probably, it could have been shit, and I probably still would have loved it. And a lot of people, well, not probably not a lot, but some people will tell you that it was shit. But I loved that game. You know, everything about it. I thought it had an incredible story. I think it was the only one of the games to have a completely accessible story with no previous knowledge in the series. And, you know, obviously partly that's due to it being chronologically the first game in the series. But, you know, it's definitely my favorite in the series. I think it has the best story. It has the most, you know, maybe well-rounded story. I don't know that I would say well-rounded, but I think it has the best story. It has some of the best moments. You know, I mean, Metal Gear Solid 1 and 2 definitely had their share of moments. One of my favorite moments from 2 was when you're trying to protect Emma from Vamp on the outside of the struts when she's trying to move to the next one. I thought that was a really great scene. You know, when EE dies, that was another great scene. Olga's death, great scene. You know, I mean, Metal Gear does death scenes very well. Always has. I imagine they always will. Unless they fuck it up here. You know, we'll see. But anyway, yeah, so 3 is my favorite. So, you know, when that game was coming out, it was at a time where you had to actually pre-order games because, you know, if you didn't, then you might not get a copy. You know, the GameStop that was by me, I think it was an EB Games at that point, still. I think it was right before it switched to GameStop. But the guy that worked there, you know, I knew him, and he was like, hey man, you know, you might actually want to pre-order this because we're not ordering a lot of copies, and almost every copy that we're ordering is already spoken for with a pre-order. So if you put in a pre-order, then we'll order another one for you, and you'll, you know, definitely get it. And I was like, all right, cool. So I pre-ordered it, and I can't remember what the situation was. I think they didn't get sent enough copies, and I didn't get there until like after work. Like, I think at that point I had, like, an after-school job. I think I had a job at that point. And I didn't get there till after work the day that it came out. And fucking they didn't have any left. They didn't get enough. And so they fulfilled all the pre-orders for people who came in before me, and I wasn't able to get mine. And so I had to wait, like, 3 more days to get mine. Tried looking other places. They didn't have it. So I just, you know, I resigned myself to waiting until, like, that Friday or whatever it was. So, I mean, it turns out the way that I played that game, it was kind of a blessing that I got it on a Friday. Yeah, so right here is where you get Maneater, and then you get a blueprint for something. I can't read what that was, but, yeah, it was a blueprint for something. And Maneater. So I finally picked it up. I called one of my buddies. I said, hey man, listen, I got this Metal Gear Solid 3. I'm going to play it. I know you're not like big into the series or anything, but I know you were interested. You should come over and check it out if you want. And he was like, all right, cool, I'll be over. So I went home, I unwrapped that bitch, stuck it in, waited for my buddy to show up. And then when he got there, we began. And now he, like I said, he didn't have a lot of experience with the series. He had never played a Metal Gear game. But also, like I said, this is that is the best game for newcomers to play because it's chronologically the first game. So you literally don't need to know anything other than what they're telling you. So me and him were sitting there playing this game, and it was so good that we sat there and beat it in one sitting. It was like a 125-hour Metal Gear Solid 3 marathon. You know, we sat there and played it from beginning to end. And by the end, we were both crying. And, you know, we went out and got some breakfast and talked about, you know, the game and what we thought the story, thought of the story and all that stuff. But yeah, so I mean, I think that that is probably when I was solidified as a Metal Gear fan for life. Was when after I beat Metal Gear Solid 3. You know, I mean, the beginning of that game, when you're doing that Halo jump, and, you know, then you find out that the boss is, you know, betrayed you, and you can't come with us, Jack, and she just knocks you off a fucking bridge, dude, like, and then you gotta fix your arm. Like, I loved all the mechanics in that game, you know, the whole having to eat. You know, you can catch your own food, and the camo system, and all that stuff, man. I loved it. And then when they finally came out with the subsistence version, and they allowed you to have free control of the camera, like, that was just, that was the perfect Metal Gear experience to me. But anyway, but yeah, so, like, you know, you go through and you do the Halo jump, and boss knocks you off the bridge, and you almost die, and then Hogan fucking nukes the facility that you were just at. You know, then Zero's like, well, we fucked it up. We're going back. You gotta take out the boss. You gotta get that nuke. You gotta get the Patriots' money, and or the Philosopher's legacy. And
he's coming too. Roger that.
And we gotta move on. So you do. You know, Snake goes back in. He meets up with Eva. He was supposed to meet up with Ocelot. That was Ocelot was Adam. He was the one that was supposed to meet with Snake and help him out. And he did in his own way. You know, but that was where they really introduced Revolver Ocelot, and they introduced him as Ocelot, and then fucking Big Boss is the one that makes him into Revolver Ocelot by telling him that, you know, his shooting technique is more suited to a revolver, and then beating his ass because of it. So, you know, that's, like, every time Ocelot and Snake meet up in that game, Ocelot is like, I'm gonna take you out this time, dude, I got you, and then Snake's like, ah, no you don't, and then it's just, like, a really, fun rivalry, I felt, you know, and it kind of gave a background for where Big Boss and Ocelot, you know, like, how they met each other and really where their relationship came from. So, I thought that was pretty cool. I think Josh Keaton did a really good job voicing Ocelot. You know, so that's definitely awesome. You know, even the Ocelot boss fight was great. I liked that a lot. All the boss fights in that game were awesome. You know, particularly the fight with the end and the fight with the boss. Those are my two favorite. You know, well, and I guess the fight with the Shagahat too. And when you're going through the woods on the bike with Eva, like, all that stuff. But anyway, you know, the fight with the end is one of my favorite boss fights of all time, really. That was just, like, it was like the perfect sniper battle. And the fact that you could actually sneak up on him was awesome. You know, or the fact that if you saved the game while you were in that fight and then didn't play it for a week, when you booted it up again, it would tell you that he had died of old age. Like, that was awesome, you know. Or the fact that you could take him out on that pier, you know, before the fight even, and then you just have to fight, like, a group of Spetsnaz in those woods. So, I mean, you still get some kind of fight, but you know, you're able to kill the end in that game without actually ever fighting him, which is really cool too. But, you know, all the bosses in that game were great. It started out with the Pain, and then you fought Ocelot, and then you fought, I think the End was next, and then the Fear, and then the Fury, and then, you know, Shagahad and Vulgan, and then finally you fight the boss. You know, and there's that game is the only one in the series that has kind of just a straightforward story arc, you know? There's no, you know, up until the very, very end, there's no real twist, you know? There's everything, it kind of just is as it seems. And even the twists in that game, while impactful and very emotional, are not huge twists, you know? They're things that make sense, unlike some of his, you know, other games. I mean, he makes everything make sense, but, you know, things seemingly don't make sense. And I think Metal Gear Solid 3 is one of the games that you can play that game and, you know, it just makes sense from beginning to end. There's no, like, oh, I really wonder what he meant by this, or, like, how did this really happen or play out or whatever. So, you know, up until the end of the game, you think that the boss has defected, and she makes you kill her. And that final fight, man, in that field of flowers, I don't know what kind of flowers those were, but those white flowers, and you gotta fight the boss, and she's one tough bitch. And he can't really CQC her, you know, but you end up taking her out, and then, yeah, you get into it with Ocelot one final time, and then, you know, you and Eva go off. There is a ride a white horse, it's in this little outpost. So then you and Eva take off, and, you know, get busy, and Snake finally gets to rest a little bit after having his eye blown out and killing, you know, his mentor slash mother figure, and, you know, he finally gets laid and gets some R&R, only to find out that Eva is a Chinese spy for the philanthropists, and, or for the philosophers, I'm sorry, not philanthropists, philosophers. And, you know, she was just trying to get the legacy the whole time. But yeah, so, you know, I mean, that was a blow to Snake. But then she leaves him a tape. And this tape says that the boss told her that she didn't really defect. That what she was doing for her country. She was protecting the U.S. by defecting... doing air quotes here, since you can't see that. But she was defecting so that, you know, Russia wouldn't retaliate against the U.S. for Volgan nuking that facility. And that was the whole reason, pretty much, why you had to kill her, was to keep up that charade, you know, to keep peace with the Soviets so that, you know, we wouldn't start World War III. And that was crazy, you know, that I think that killed Snake a little bit inside, you know, and I think that was really, that was the moment that defined where he was going to end up. That was the moment where he said, okay, well, fuck this, you know, if this is what it's going to be, then I don't want it. And he rejects the title of Big Boss, and he leaves the country, and he starts his own, you know, private military force, being the Military Without Borders, or Military Sans Frontières, if that's how you want to say it. You know, and that's where he really got the idea for an outer heaven, you know, a place where soldiers can be themselves, and they're not going to die for anybody but themselves, and they're only going to take the jobs that they want to take, and they're not going to have to, you know, be stuck up in all this espionage shit, and they're not going to be used by governments and all this stuff. And that's what Big Boss wanted. You know, he felt that was the boss's ideal. You know, he later comes to realize that the boss's ideal was just to leave the world the fuck alone and let everybody live their lives and you know, excise, you know, use their own will to do what they want. But at this point, you know, he feels like that was really her idea was to have a nation where soldiers don't have to be used by governments. You know, they're not going to be anybody's puppets. And so that was a really great ending to the game, I thought. You know, and the final scene where you see Snake saluting the president, getting the title of Big Boss. You know, if you there's like a hidden button prompt there. If you hit, I think it's R1 or R2, whatever it is, you can see Ocelot in the window behind the president, which I thought was a cool touch. But yeah, you know, I mean, that game, it was incredible. You know, I like I said, I cried at the end, and I loved it. You know, it's one of my favorite games of all time. Definitely my favorite Metal Gear game. You know, like I said earlier, none of these, the first three, are really easy to go back to gameplay wise. They're great. You know, and the stories are great, but the gameplay is a bit dated at this point. Now this game, I feel like this game is going to last for a long time. I feel like the gameplay in this one is as perfect as a gameplay can get, and I think this game is going to be one to transcend the time in a way that the others didn't, simply because of that. But anyway, yeah, so MGS3, that was my experience with that, and that was my favorite. You know, and then obviously after that, I was super hyped for MGS4. Now, I don't remember if Peace Walker came first or if 4 came first. I think 4 came out and then Peace Walker came out. Because I remember being disappointed that the next mainline game was going to be a PSP game. Because at that point, I had had a PSP and then sold it because, you know, I had played all the games that I wanted to play. And as far as I was aware, there wasn't anything else coming out that really interested me. So, you know, I didn't feel like I needed it. I sold it and ended up getting some other games. So I didn't play Peace Walker until I got a Vita, and then I picked it up on there. But we'll get to that. I want to talk about 4 first. So then, you know, they start advertising and talking about Metal Gear Solid 4, and they show that first original trailer at, I think it was a TGS trailer, where it's all in first person for the most part, and then it pans out to show you that it's, you know, it's Snake. And I thought that was awesome. I was really afraid that they were going to make the game first person, but they were just adding a first person viewpoint, which was fine. I used it plenty in that game. I use it plenty in this game. You know, I think it was a good addition. But that game really laid the gameplay groundwork for the Phantom Pain as far as controls go. Obviously, the gameplay ideas and mechanics came from Peace Walker, because this game is really just a blown-up, fully realized Peace Walker. But yeah, 4 laid the control groundwork. And that game, I thought, was great. A lot of people don't like it. You know, I'm not going to say that there wasn't a shit ton of cutscenes in that game, because there are. And there, you know, if you play the game and you know what you're doing, and you just you move through the game, completing your objectives in a timely manner, you are going to spend more time in that game watching cutscenes than actually playing it. I did it, and that is what happened. Which I was fine with, because I liked all of those cutscenes. I thought they were all great. You know, I think that was a very fitting end to the story and the series as a whole. You know, I didn't expect them to make any more Metal Gear games after that. I thought that it was just a great send-off for Snake and the series as a whole. Now, a lot of people were disappointed because Snake didn't die at the end of that game. That also disappointed me, too. I think that Solid Snake should have died at the end of that game. But I guess the team at Kojima Productions didn't like that ending, so and they boycotted it enough that Kojima changed it. But that game was great, and it was full of moments as well, great moments. One thing that I want to talk about, one of my favorite scenes from Metal Gear Solid 3 that I forgot to mention earlier, was the scene where you're climbing that huge fucking ladder, and you're just climbing this ladder, and then, you know, the chick starts singing the Snake Eater song, and, like, that was just... That was an incredible moment that you can't really get outside of games, because, you know... I mean, you could film a scene like that, but it's not going to have the same impact, because... You know, that song played depending on how fast you were climbing the ladder and whether or not you stopped. You know, it would slow down or stop, if I'm remembering correctly. But anyway, so moving back on to 4. It was a great game. You know, I liked the story. I think that they wrapped everything up nicely. You know, some people are upset that things got explained away with nanomachines like Vamp. But honestly, that makes sense in this world to me. So I didn't really have an issue with it. They brought Raiden back and made him extra cool. You know, I thought he was cool to begin with. And when he came back as a cyborg ninja, he was just awesome. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. He was great. But, you know, that game has a lot of really intense moments, too. You know, like Shadow Moses. When you return to Shadow Moses and you have to go through all those facilities again, like, that was probably my favorite part of that game, was Shadow Moses, and then the subsequent fight between your Metal Gear Rex and, you know, Liquid Ocelot's Metal Gear Ray. That was definitely one of the finer moments in that game. Then you have you know, the battlefield where Snake is trying to reach Naomi and Laughing Octopus to get to that fight. If you kill enough people, I think you can do this at any point in that game, but if you kill enough people, Snake will vomit. You know, he'll become sick with himself, and you'll hear, like, Liquid talking to him and telling him some garbage, and then he just yukes it all over the ground, which I thought was a really cool touch. You know, obviously, in all these games, there's just interesting little things. Like, in that game, you can get a it's like an old Japanese rifle that you can get that shoots fucking tornadoes out of it. Like, that's crazy. But, yeah, so, you know, I mean, 4 was a fitting end to the series. You know, it had a lot of great moments. Like I said, Shadow Moses, the fight with Liquid, you know, the microwave hallway. Awesome, awesome things. You know, when you're finally fighting Liquid Ocelot at the end, and it's you know, morphing through all the different versions of Metal Gear over the years, like, that was one of the coolest things I think I've seen. That was an awesome boss fight. The boss fights in that game are a lot of fun, too. Different things that you can do with them. I liked the Crying Wolf fight was probably my favorite one. The Raging Raven fight was pretty cool. The Mantis fight was okay. You know, there's no way to emulate that first experience from when you're fighting Psycho Mantis and Metal Gear Solid 1 for the first time. So I feel like that was... It was kind of hard for them to live up to that. So, I found that... I think that was okay. But nothing spectacular. And then, you know, the Laughing Octopus fight was fine as well. Yeah, so that's all for the Beauty and the Beast core. And then, you know, a lot of people had issues with Drebin. I thought he was fine. Him and his monkey were funny enough. Turns out he's an agent of the Patriots as well. He's the one that put some mutated fox dye inside a snake. That, you know, then is going to destroy the world or whatever it is. Turns out that's not the case. Just kills Big Boss, because Big Boss shows up at the fucking end of the game. So, you know, you go through the microwave hallway, you defeat Liquid, everything turns out hunky-dory. Snake's standing at the boss's grave, about to blow his brains out. And, or no, I think he was standing at Big Boss's grave. He's about to blow his brains out, and then Big Boss shows up, wheeling in Major Zero. And, you know, Big Boss tells him, pretty much fills him in on everything, you know, says, hey, oh, by the way, that was Take on Me back there. That was where you get that tape. So that's the third tape. You get that here. So three possible tapes in this mission. Man-Eater, Ride a White Horse, and Take on Me. Now, Big Boss shows up, tells Snake that he has pretty much done more to achieve the boss's true ideals than, you know, Big Boss himself ever really did, and that he's proud of him, and then he dies from the fox eye. Not before he kills Major Zero, though. Turns off the old man's oxygen, and Zero croaks just like Big Boss. So I thought that was a really fitting end to the series. You know, I did want Snake to die. You know, I think it would have been okay if he had, you know, killed himself. I think that it would have been okay if him and Otacon were executed like Kojima originally intended. I think that would have been fine as well. But, you know, it is what it is, and I thought that the ending was fine. It was a fitting ending to the series. You know, I had a lot of fun with all the games. You know, they told the story that I enjoyed. And they were all fun. You know, that's what it boils down to, is they're a lot of fun. And it's, you know, the fun in these games is, part of it is the goofiness, you know? There's a lot of just silly, goofy things in these games that, you know, may seem like it doesn't really belong in a game with such serious, you know, themes. But Kojima makes it work, and I love him for it. You know, I'm really, really excited to see what he's going to do next. You know, where he's going to move, or what kind of game he's going to make. You know, because really, he could go anywhere. You know, my hope is that, honestly, if he's going to go and work with, like, a big company or publisher and not just open up his own studio, that he goes to Sony. Simply because I prefer the Sony products. I don't really like the way that Microsoft handled themselves up until, you know, Phil Spencer came on board. So, you know, and Sony has been doing a bang-up job for a long time. So, Well, I shouldn't say they've been doing a bang-up job for a long time, but they've been on an upward trajectory for a long time. And I'd rather Kojima go with them if he's going to go with one of the big two. But it looks like that's it for today. Mission's about to be over. We're getting to our landing zone here. I didn't have a chance to talk about Peace Walker or any of the other portable entries in the series, so I do apologize for that. I guess my thoughts on the other games just ran a little long. But maybe I'll talk about that stuff next time. I don't know why I couldn't get him on the horse here. It just wasn't working, so I ended up just running with him to the chopper. So maybe next time I'll talk more about Peace Walker and, Portable Ops and, Metal Gear Acid and Acid 2 and Ghost Babel. I never played Ghost Babel at all. I don't even know what that game is about. I never even read about it. So I can't really speak too much about that. But the other stuff I have some experience with, at the very least. So there's that. Now, as far as uploads, this is going to be going up on Tuesday, September 22nd. I will have another bigger upload of a mission on this upcoming Sunday. Between now and then, I may have a couple of other smaller videos to put up, maybe some things with, like, the Rocket Fist or, smaller funny things like that. But I'm not sure. If I have the time to do that stuff, then I want to and I will. If not, then you'll just have to wait until Sunday for your next beefcake fix. But thank everybody for watching. I do appreciate it. If you have any comments, if there's anything, if I screwed something up, or I was wrong and you want to correct me, or you just want to debate something or just talk about the story or anything at all, just throw me a comment. I'd be happy to talk about anything you guys want to talk about with you. Like, comment, subscribe, if you will, if you want. Thanks again for watching, and I will see you guys all next time here on Beefcake Games.
You extracted Malak is saying that he's never heard of our client. What's more, he says his village was destroyed long before he was ever taken prisoner. Apparently it fell victim to some sort of disease, then was completely burned to the ground. Malak was out on a mission at the time, and that's the reason why he alone survived. But the question is, who hired us to find him? According to Malak, he saw strange soldiers snooping around the village when he got back. Turns out they were members of Cypher Strike Force XOF. My theory is they wanted to get their hands on Malak to question or silence him before the Soviets could get to him. Cypher was just using us to cover things up. All that crap about Malak's relative was a front to convince us to retrieve him. But an entire colony just wiped off the map. It sounds a lot like the Hameed during the Honeybee incident. All I know, boss, is there's no way in hell I'm handing Malak over to Cypher. I decided to bring him back to Mother Base instead. He's one of us now. We told the client through a cutout that the target was killed. For some reason, though, they still paid us everything we were owed. Cypher's obviously up to something, and this is probably just another preemptive cleanup operation to them. But to Malak, he lost his village, his family, everything, and he wants his revenge. In other words, he's one of us.